those things in contemporary life. For what is the futuristic vision? What is the aim for all of those things in bringing a global brotherhood? This is how we have to deal with heritage. The third thing is religious renaissance. Whenever a system is subjected to a disease, we must try to cure it. Or whenever it is beyond our cure, we have to amputate it, that we are doing in medical systems. So we have to see that it is immediately considered and it is immediately taken care of. For example, political system, there is corruption. Education system, there is quality reduction. Professional system, there is lack of commitment. So everywhere, not only in religious systems, everywhere there is a totalitarian degradation. We see biodegradation and geo-degradation. What about the religion? It is also part of society. So whatever we are seeing as degradation is not exclusive for religion at all, but as religion is having higher and more vehement sentiments, which are very much ubiquitous in the society, that must be cared for. That's why I used to say, all professions are noble in nature. They are noble. And when you are capable of serving others, that profession naturally becomes nobler. Even if you get something professional for money transaction, that profession, if it is following the ethical standards, that is noble. If you consider the society and relax or make yourself more flexible, that becomes nobler. And safeguarding the life of people and restoring their salubrity and homeostasis, that the medical profession is said to be the noblest. So somebody committing mistake is different from the medical professional person doing mistake. It is entirely different. A butcher killing a goat is entirely different from the parental or the mother goat killing its own goat. So it is the duty of protection, prevention and assurance of the essential resources for a fruitful extended life. So if there the ethical implementation is violated, that becomes a cruel and brutal, heinous, inexcusable offense. Likewise, in religion, it is a possibility for purification for everybody. If it itself is impure, then that is a heinous danger to the society. Now in religion, we are having a lot of problems. One is superstition. Second thing is religious violence. Third thing, non-contribution to the society. Religion does not contribute anything to the society. If it is contributed, the fourth problem is self-centrism. So religion is pestered by self-centric people, non-contributors to society, superstitious beliefs and practices, and violence in the society. So it must be taken care by the students. They cannot totally eradicate the religious system, or they cannot create a deen-ilahi. New system cannot be created, or all systems cannot be easily synchronized and synergized. So they have to be maintained in their own standards, removing this speed. So it is known as religious renaissance that must be brought for real nationalization. And the final point is, there is accusation. Whenever you start something, somebody will accuse. Nationalization is always considered to be a very narrow approach. So somebody says that if there is mere nationalization in no broader standards, then it is against globalization or global standards or universal brotherhood or global village. It is not like that. It is concentration. See, whenever you are going to support somebody, if somebody has fallen inside the well, and anybody who is going to support and make the person to come out the well, then he will balance himself in such a sturdity so that he can pull the person. So nationalism is not against internationalism or globalization. The so-called pseudo-globalization, in which the major power blocks of the world, they only develop by exploiting the temptation and resources of few committed developing countries, it is not globalization. Real globalization is founded on the base of nationalization. Unless you are strong and well organized, you cannot deal with the international people without sacrificing our dignity and standards. So that's what we want. So this is what we call nationalization, that we have clearly explained. Now coming into the other developmental standards, how to create our own inner strength. Number one, there are two things. You have to form a team and you have to deform the already existing team. I told in one seminar on terrorism, the only strength for terrorists is they are organized. They are integrated. And the only weakness for us is we are not organized. If 10 terrorists unite together for destruction, daily they will meet and discuss till the destruction is implemented. But wherever if we speak about construction, immediately we will forget and we will be thinking about something else. And the second thing is, if two people work for construction, they will be having egoistic clashes. You or me. If somebody, two people or five people or a gang of people, if they work for some destruction, forgetting their egoism, they will concentrate only on the destruction. So this type of quality, at least we need not to learn from the sages, seers and scholars of the society. We have to learn only from the terrorists, and that we have to apply on salubrious standards and execution. So this is the level of the society now. So now we have to create three things. If we are integral, then the other people will be afraid. To create fear in the minds of the people, we want to do two things. One is to be integral, and second is to create military as well as retributive judicial strength in the country so that everything will be proper. The second thing is 5-5 phenomena. If you are integral, if you have proper retributive justice also, and also if you have proper military strength, then that will develop the country and that will create permanent fear on the other people. Now it has created permanent fear on the subjects of the nation, not on the other community. It has created perennial fear. Now the terrorists are in competence solace, and the so-called people who are assured competence solace, they are in evergreen terror. So we must have patriotism, we must have pride, we must have pity, we must have privilege, and we must have prestige. Yes, it is my duty to protect, I have to do that. And it is my inborn instinct that I have to take care of the land which gives me solace, comfort, shelter and shadow. And it is my pride that to be born on this land. And the contemporary situation is very pitiable. So anything like patriotism, the soil connection, our pity, our privilege, our prestige, or any of these things,
Swamiji, for your inspiring, enlightening and valuable words.